patients.
Thank you very much, Tai. It's a great honor for me to speak in this workshop. And congratulations to Laurent and Marie-Françoise on your 70th birthday, on the celebrations of your 70th birthday. Your work was always a source of great inspiration for me. And I also have very good memories of my two visits to Tours. I think it was 2005 for the Serin conference, which was mentioned already, and probably then in 2007. And I had very nice recollections of those visits. So today I'm going to talk about something which is not close. I had some work which is very closely related and inspired by your earlier works. But today I'm going to talk about something which is maybe less close to you, about Choquard equation, which were my fascination for the past several years. And this is a very recent work. Most of this talk is a very recent work with Zeng Liu, who visited me in Swansea last year. But I will start with a little introduction into Choquard equations, and I will explain where was the origin and what is the recent landscape in this area. So Choquard equations, they were introduced by Leap, mathematically, they were introduced to mathematicians by Leap in 1977, when he published a very short paper, a very deep paper, maybe about 10 or 15 pages long. And Choquard equation is here. So this is, we can say it's semi-linear equation, but instead of standard nonlinear power, we have convolution. Everything happens in R3. So here on the left, we have green function of the Laplacian, or we can read it just as inverse Laplacian. So this is non-local. And the energy has this form, again, standard Schrödinger type part equation in the quadratic part. And here we have non-local convolution term. So what Leap did in his work, he proved existence of positive ground state. He proved the of radial monotone decreasing ground states. He mentions that the ground state decay exponentially, and he also proved uniqueness of ground states. This uniqueness is a very delicate result. I will comment on this later. This was studied later by Pierre Lyons and a few other people. Lyons studied it as a part of his famous concentration compactness studies in 82-83. But there wasn't much result on Choquard equation after that for many years. There was also some ambiguity, because the same equation, often called Schrödinger-Newton equation or attractive or focusing Hartree equation, Choquard equation. And this is related to the way how this equation is derived in different physical models, but mathematically, these are the same equations. So to explain a little bit about these equations with non-local interactions, how I sometimes call it and how they're sometimes called in the literature. So here I give a little survey of different classes and types of equations with non-local interactions. So in our Choquard equation, interaction is attractive. It's typically particles with gravitation between particles. So here on the left-hand side, you have your Schrödinger equation with the potential of your choice, which is linear. But you are now live in a system which contains many particles, a multi-particle system. So, and you can try to describe this by linear n-body Schrödinger operator, which is incredibly complicated to compute and to study. Or instead, you can look at approximations. Instead of trying to describe the wave function of every particle, you simply introduce the particle density. So the square of u is density of particles in multi-particle systems. And then you have your Schrödinger part on the left. And the non-local part typically absorbs all interactions between particles in the system. Or sometimes you can have several non-local parts accommodating different types of interaction. So if you have sign plus here, this is attractive force, typically gravitation. Sign minus is repulsion, think electrostatic repulsion between electrons. And you can have short-range corrections. So the order of convolution, he already wrote race potential with normalization constant. So when alpha goes to zero, this expression converges in some sense, in some weak sense, to delta function. And then we have short-range interactions when particles interact only with their neighbors. When alpha gets bigger, close to n, this is a very long-range interaction between particles. In Schrödinger-Poisson type model, you have a combination of repulsive non-local interaction, long-range interaction, and local short-range interaction terms. Some additional terms could be added here. All this can be written as a system, but it doesn't help much because this system is literally equivalent to the equation. So it's just a matter of taste and preference. How you write it, you're dealing with the same object. The power here always 2, which is somehow dictated by most of the physical models, or most popular physical models. And what we did with Jean van Schaftingen around 2013, probably a bit earlier, we decided to look at this equation and we wrote a general power P instead of power Q, so we would make it in a proper nonlinearity. And we considered a Ries potential, which from now I will denote I alpha as a standard notation. So with this normalization constant is just the inverse of the fractional Laplacian. And P here will be bigger than 1. Alpha is anything between 0 and n, where Ries potential is well defined, and n will be greater or equal than 2. So when alpha is 0, formally we pick up the standard semilinear equation everybody here knows very well. Just note the power, so the power because of the structure it becomes 2p rather than p. So at the time, as I said, the beyond original leap work and work by Pierre-Louis Lyon, there were just several papers on the subject, and we published with Jean 5 or 6, maybe 7 papers on different topics, studying Choquard equation from point of view of nonlinear variational analysis. So our very first paper was in fact very close in spirit to some of the Laurent and Marie-Françoise works. And we studied some Liouville theorems of serine type and decay of solutions. Oops, sorry for this equation. We studied existence and properties of ground states. We studied case when u to the power p is replaced by general nonlinearities. We studied semiclassical concentration at local minima of the potential. And little later, jointly with Marco Gimenti, we studied and we discovered remarkable least action nodal solutions for the Choquard equation. These are solutions which do not exist for the classical local nonlinear Schrodinger equation case. Only for Choquard, for alpha bigger than 0, you can get this solution. So this is something completely new in the non-local case. And after the studies, I think Jean is here, and Jean will remember that we thought we published 6 or 7 papers on the topic of Choquard. Okay, I will show first the typical result in one of our first papers. So this is 2013. And this is a standard and probably the simplest one can imagine Choquard equation in generalized setting. So here nonlinearity is V to the power P. We work in Rn and we proved that in this range, this Choquard equation admits a radially decreasing positive ground state solution in H1, in Sobolev space H1. Ground state means that it appears as a certain, some sort of constraint minimization. And so first of all, I will look at the interval P. So of course, when alpha is 0, you will immediately recognize that P could change between 1 and n over n minus 2. If you multiply it by 2, here on the right, you get standard Sobolev exponent. And on the left, you have number 2. So this is just standard existence interval for this equation in the local case alpha 0. In the non-local case, we pick up here non-trivial, what we call lower critical exponent, which is due to Hardy Littlewood Sobolev inequality. And on the right-hand side, we have this number is analog, almost complete analog of the standard critical Sobolev exponent. So in this range, Choquard equation admit equation, and this existence interval is optimal, which easily follows from Pahajaev identity. The most interesting here in this setting is asymptotic behavior. And what we discovered in our work, when P is bigger than 2, then this ground state has a standard exponential decay, which everyone who coming from local Schrodinger equation would expect to have, like in the local case alpha 0. When P is less than 2, we have polynomial decay of this range, which already involves alpha and P, which sees the order of nonlinearity here. In the intermediate case P equal 2, which corresponds to most of physical models and which was studied by Lip, we still have exponential decay, but with a very delicate exponential correction, which I don't have time to explain now, but I just emphasize that this is non-trivial. And this number mu here depends in some cases on the actual norm of the solution itself. So this is somehow self-referenced non-local decays, typically non-local problems, when decay of the solution is not universal, but depends on the norm of the solution. This number nu is a function of the L2 norm of the ground state V. I mentioned also about the uniqueness. Uniqueness here, there were several papers, a number of papers recently about the uniqueness, but the uniqueness is mostly open. And the papers, the result about uniqueness, which appears are essentially small perturbations of the leap result when P equal 2 or alpha equal 2, either with respect to alpha or with respect to 2. And they all work using small perturbation technique, small perturbation of the leap case. Apparently, the leap physical case P equal 2 and alpha 2 has lots of very special symmetries and very special structure, which makes it easier for uniqueness analysis and for many other things, and which makes it difficult for different things. But so far, uniqueness for Choquard equation in a full setting, which we expect here, the ground state to be unique. But this is so far, as far as we know, at least open. So yes, so I was saying that after publishing 6 or 7 papers on Choquard equation, we later with Jean both decided that we will never work on Choquard equation again, that we had enough of it, and we will look at something else. Yet, never say never. So about a year, little more than a year ago, a young Chinese mathematician Zhang Liu came to visit me in Swansea for 6 months, and he wanted to learn something about Choquard equation, and we decided to look at the equation which we have here. So this is our standard Choquard, but I moved nonlinearity on the left for certain aesthetical, so to say, reasons. Combined with the local term u to the power q. So this is combination of non-local attractive force and short-range repulsive force. Equation of this type, and the reason why I started looking at it approximately at the same time, I came across physical or rather astrophysical papers coming from the group of French astrophysicist whose name probably should be pronounced Chavani, and he studied physically, non-rigorously, something what he calls self-gravitating Bose-Einstein condensate, which is described in our terms precisely by this equation here. And if you look at this equation carefully, what we have here in black on the left-hand side, this is standard local defocusing Gross-Pitayevsky equation, and those who worked on this type of applications will know that this describes Bose-Einstein condensate in the focusing case. But then Chavani claims that addition of self-gravitation terms of non-local attraction changes the properties of the system dramatically. And he published several long physical papers, and I looked at the result in those papers, and some of those results I couldn't recognize mathematically. So I just was wondering, so what is going on here? I don't understand what he is saying. So when Zhang came to China, we decided, okay, we'll look at this equation in the general setting and we'll see what we'll find out. So here, I alpha is, and this is the main topic of my talk today in our recent result today. So here, what we have here is standard trace potential. We have alpha between 0 and n. We have p, which is a priori any number bigger than 1, and q is bigger than 2. And epsilon is a small or large parameter. Epsilon in this model very roughly represents the total mass of the particle. Epsilon is, if you want, mass to which our system constrained. The proper setting here would be to look at mass constraint minimization, but this is very, very difficult. So the easier case is just to put term epsilon u here in the equation with epsilon as a free parameter. So we will be interested in the limiting behavior of this when epsilon is small or large. And this is what typically physicists want to see, because for them, epsilon represents a certain parameter in the system, and they're interested in the asymptotic behavior. So this is my setting of the problem. But we do it, of course, in the general setting rather than this particular physical setting. And I will show you on the next slide the local analog of this. Local analog of this is well known and classical, and existence goes back to Beristicki-Lyons, and uniqueness is very delicate and tricky here to paper, to a series of papers by Serin and Tang. But essentially here in this setting, so this is precisely the same equation with the power 2p, which is consistent with non-local case, but I take alpha zero here. So of course, when we look at the nonlinearity, we see that when Q is bigger than 2P, this term, this coercive term dominates in the equation. And when Q is less 2P, the anti-coercive term dominates in the equation. When Q bigger than 2P, we have something like coercive structure or mountain pass structure in the other case. Doesn't make sense to consider the case when Q equal to P because nonlinearity degenerates. And what follows from Beristicki-Leon's results in 83, when Q is less than 2P, then for any epsilon, this equation has a positive ground state solution. In the complementary case, when Q is bigger than 2P, this equation has positive ground state only for small epsilon. And this is sharp. For large epsilon, there is no positive ground state, as easily follows from Pahajaev. This is easy to see. So this solution is radial, monotone decreasing, exponentially decaying, and unique according to Sering and Tang. So these results are standard, but some 5-6 years ago with Kirill Muratov, we studied asymptotic profiles of this solution as epsilon goes to zero. In this case, in the case when Q is bigger than 2P, and we discovered rather complicated picture, which I would not describe today on its own because it will be part of our results on Choquard equation. So in certain sense, what I'm going to talk is Choquard extension of our work with Kirill Muratov. This work with Muratov was also extended recently to P-Laplacian, where there are also some interesting phenomena, but today I'm going to talk about non-local problem. So here is our first result, and this result is in a sense existence. So I fix epsilon here. This is extension of Beristicki-Leon's. And when you try to study this non-local equation, so the first question which puzzles you and you don't see immediate answer. So what is the threshold between Q and P here? Because the taking Q equal to P here doesn't really make sense as the scalings don't go in the same way because of the convolution term. But once you look at it more carefully, you realize that this power represents the threshold, and this power is related to Hardy, Littlewood, Sobolev inequality. And it's not too difficult to show once you understood the general setup that this equation has positive ground state, radial monotone decreasing ground state solution, either for any Q bigger than 2 and P in the subcritical range, or for P supercritical and Q bigger than this threshold solution. Let me move to next page to show you the picture because this results convenient to understand looking at the PQ plane. So this is the values of P, this is values of Q on the vertical axis. This is interval of P where non-local term makes sense, where everything is well posed from the point of view of non-local term. And non-local term always dominating it somehow determines what happens in the system, and local term can be seen as a perturbation of non-local term in certain aspects. So when P is subcritical, like for the standard Choquard equation, we have existence of ground state for any Q bigger than 2. This is a threshold line, determined by the Hardy-Littlewood-Sobolev equation, by the Hardy-Littlewood-Sobolev scaling, I could say. When P is supercritical, we have existence of solutions only for Q bigger than this Hardy-Littlewood-Sobolev number. This region is sharp. Outside of this region, there is no positive, or there is no any finite energy ground state to our problem, and this easily follows for Pahajaev. Boundaries of the region also belong to non-existence, except of this special point where you can actually construct explicit solution from minimizers of Hardy-Littlewood-Sobolev inequality. So this ground state has different behavior when P is bigger. So the decay here is precisely the same. In this case, the decay is precisely the same as in the standard Choquard case. When P is bigger than 2, we have standard exponential decay. When P equal to, we have this tricky exponential decay with delicate control. And when P is less than 2, we have polynomial decay of the ground states. Uniqueness is completely open, and generally we would expect uniqueness, but this is open. So a little bit about the technique, how we prove it. So this is the energy for this problem. and we consider essentially we consider minimization on Pakhajaev manifold. So you can write corresponding Pakhajaev identity, and you look for this is a natural constraint for the problem, and we minimize on the Pakhajaev manifold, and we control the non-local term using Hardy-Littlewood-Sobolev inequality. So this is already on the next slide. So this is energy level on the Pakhajaev manifold in few of the solutions. The energy bounded below, and you get existence in a more or less following more or less standard, at least for those who work on Choquard equations, is standard techniques. Remarkably, we get existence for any epsilon bigger than zero. Unlike in the local case, there is no upper bound on epsilon. So even in the supercritical case, when QP is supercritical and Q is large, we have existence for any epsilon. As I mentioned, our PQ region is sharp. Uniqueness is completely open and probably extremely difficult problem. Regularity is hard, and we spent a long time trying to get regularity, and the crucial step which was missing is L infinity bound. Once you have L infinity bound, you of course can proceed in a standard way. L infinity bound in the local case would be proved immediately by maximum principle, but in this setting you don't have maximum you don't really have maximum principle. And L infinity bound becomes tricky. And so I spent some, I would say, sleepless night trying to catch L infinity. Everything you know that doesn't work or work for very restricted and unnatural set of parameters. And then I asked Augusto, because at some point we realized that this type of bound would help us to get uniqueness. And Augusto Pons immediately replied, and he mentioned that this is exercise 415. In his book. It's not a trivial exercise. It has a certain proof, but this result by Augusto, I'm really grateful to him, because it was exactly what we needed. And this is what ensured the proof of regularity. This is a remarkable result on its own. So it tells, if you look at the local equation of this structure on subsolution of this equation with the right hand side F, and F belongs to LS with arbitrary S, then the term here, v to the q minus 1, also belong to Ls, and we have this contraction bound with universal constant 1, which doesn't depend on solution, on dimension, on S, doesn't depend on anything. And this was crucial for us to establish L infinity bound and regularity. So my next result, so I want now to move to more difficult part of this, and in a sense, more interesting part of it. I want to consider the behavior when epsilon goes to zero. And when epsilon goes to zero, we want to consider, of course, we get something we call formal zero mass limit. This is terminology was picked up by Beristiki and Lyons in the same paper when they called this zero mass case. So we can write a zero mass Choquard equation. As far as we know, it wasn't studied before. And roughly with the same techniques, we can prove this existence theorem. So this zero mass limit equation admits a radial decreasing positive ground state solution in D1. Now you work not in H1, but in D1. If P is subcritical, then the solution belongs to L1. We don't know exactly, we have a conjecture, but we don't know exact pointwise decay, but to be in L1 is sufficient for everything we need. When P is bigger, when P is supercritical, then this solution is dominated below by the green function of the Laplacian. We believe that this bound is optimal, and we have partial proof under some unnatural restrictions, but also this result enough for our purposes in what follows to study the asymptotic behavior. So what is this range? Let me come back to previous slide. What is this range here? How do we grasp this range here? I come back to this picture. This is existence region for the equation with positive epsilon. The limit equation has ground states only in these two triangles. It has ground state here, and in this triangle here, above critical Hardy-Littlewood-Sobolev exponent, and in the triangle here below critical Hardy-Littlewood-Sobolev exponent. This is sharp. In this region, in the complement, there is no ground states for the limit equation. So with this in mind, so we consider now the family of equations. we send epsilon to zero and we get formal limit. And you can prove that indeed, when both equations have ground state solutions simultaneously, ground states u epsilon converge to ground states u zero as epsilon goes to zero in all reasonable norms. So this is C2 convergence on Rn, and we converge in D1 and LQ norms. And the key to prove this is to simply to prove that energy level, the minimum Pachajaev manifold, converges to the limit energy level. And this is done by testing. So this is standard and easy trick. You plug in u epsilon into S0. You plug in u0 into S epsilon. Here you have to be careful because u0 sometimes is not NL2, but you plug in a suitable and careful cutoff of u0 into S epsilon, and you get convergence. Let me note that this is not a small perturbation result. P epsilon is well posed in H1. The limit problem is well posed in D1, and they are different spaces. As I mentioned already, U0 is not in a one, at least when N is equal 3 and 4, if we believe that this bound is, this lower bound in, is actually asymptotic. Okay. So this is a picture, this is now the picture, the total picture, which I will want to explain you by the end of the talk of what happens in the Choquard. So this is p-axis, this is q-axis. Here you have p0 limit, here you have, we have p0 limit. And the question, what happens outside? So what happens when p epsilon has a ground state in these regions here and p0 does not have a ground state? And this is my next step, and it's not a very difficult step. So what you do, of course, our problem is scaling invariant, and you consider this family of rescalings, which transforms problem P epsilon into the family of equivalent equations. So when we look at P epsilon, this is, of course, just one possible way to write it. You can choose any equation of this family, and they're all equivalent to each other. It's just a matter of preference. And you look at this family, so first observation, you know that you observe that when q is equal to this number, you can balance all four terms in the equation. You can get, so you will have this power, this power, this power, and this power equal. You drop epsilon and you reduce everything to this equation which does not have epsilon. In terms of rescalings, so what does it mean in terms of rescalings? This means that any solution of P epsilon is a self-rescaling, is a rescaling of solution of problem P1. If you know solution of P1, you know solution of any P epsilon. And this is what is stated in this theorem, which is almost evident, it doesn't really require proof, that if P is subcritical and Q equal to this critical number, then this rescaling of solution U1 is a solution of the problem P epsilon. This is this green line here on the PQ diagram. So you wonder what happens in other regions. So this is self-rescaling regime. This is P0 and P0 formal rescaling. Next region I'm going to look is what is called here Choquard region. This is a region above the green line here. Okay. And when you look at Choquard region, so this is what we call formally first rescaling. So your next observation, when you look at the family of equations with epsilon, you can balance three powers here, here, and here, divide, and you get epsilon just on this term. And then you observe that when epsilon goes to zero and Q is bigger than this number, then this term goes to zero, this term disappears, and you get formal limit, but for this rescaled equation. Again, once you did this proof once, you can prove a second time very easily this theorem that when P is in this, P and Q are in this region, as epsilon goes to zero, the rescaled solution, V epsilon, converges to the solution of the Choquard equation, because this is now standard Choquard from the beginning of my talk, becomes the limit equation. So we are now, let me try, okay, so this is the technique I learned. Apparently one can switch between the screens in the full screen. So this is the region here. In this region here, Choquard equation is our limit equation. So next region I'm going to cover is this region, which we call Thomas Fermi, which appeared most mysterious and surprising for us in this study. So I do the standard procedure, and we call this second rescaling. You can do a different choice of powers and rescalings. You can balance powers on these three terms, here, here, and here, and you get epsilon into certain power on the first term on the Laplacian. And as again, you observe that when epsilon goes to zero, and Q is in this regime, which corresponds to the yellow region on my diagram, then epsilon here goes to zero, and we get as a formal limit this equation. This is something what is called Thomas Fermi equation, at least in physical models. This is called Thomas Fermi equation. And this looks strange, and we feel probably uncomfortable because it doesn't involve Laplacian term. It is equation in LP, and the corresponding energy is well defined in L2 intersection LQ. Of course, it is right that you can transform it to the elliptic equation in some special cases and under some circumstances, but we are not going to do this because this is precisely what appears as our limit object. But if you look at this energy, you realize that it's not difficult to minimize this energy in the LP space. You use Hardy-Littlewood-Sobolev inequality, and what you need to do, you write interpolation inequality. So, as I mentioned here, if Q is bigger than Hardy-Littlewood-Sobolev exponent, and if Hardy-Littlewood-Sobolev exponent is bigger than 2, which requires restriction on P, then we simply can write this interpolation. This is Hardy-Littlewood-Sobolev, this is standard Hölder interpolation, this is sharp constant in HLS. You get the interpolation inequality, and you can prove, if you look at the proof of original Hardy-Littlewood-Sobolev inequality in Lipp's paper, you can prove using similar techniques, and it's not difficult, that there is a minimizer for the interpolation inequality. So this is my theorem, that this inequality admit an optimizer, which corresponds after some rescaling to a non-negative radial non-increasing ground state, which belongs to W1 and intersection LQ of the Thomas Fermi equation on the previous page. So next question we try to understand is the decay. We need to know the decay of those limit ground states because we eventually will want to insert them into the equation with positive epsilon. So we need to know very carefully the integrability property. And here we got a surprise. So apparently, when P is less than 2, then support of our Thomas Fermi ground state is all of Rn, and they decay polynomially, and this is and this is exactly the same decay as you saw in the case P less than 2 for the standard Choquard equation. When P is bigger than 2, greater or equal than 2, then support of those ground state is compact. It's a ball of certain radius r, which could be estimated if you need it. And they look as a linear combination of characteristic function of the ball plus a function which is equal to zero on the boundary of its support. So this is a sort of a hat which is flying over the zero level surface. When p is bigger than 2, then coefficient lambda here is strictly positive. When p equal 2, then coefficient lambda equals zero. And we have, so in p equal 2, we have free boundary and at least continuous ground state. If p is bigger than 2, we have free boundary but discontinuous ground state, and we have a positive jump of level lambda here. This comes from not very difficult analysis, ODE analysis, because everything is radial here. And then the convergence when epsilon goes to zero is standard, but I should say that we still have some technical troubles with the case alpha bigger than one. So let me announce this result for alpha bigger than one only. We believe we could get the proof for other ranges by for alpha less or equal than one, but this is not completed yet. So the result, as you expected already, the rescaled ground states V epsilon, they converge to the limit profile, which is the ground state of the Thomas Fermi equation. Here I left empty space because I wanted to produce nice pictures this morning, but I should say the talks this morning in the workshop were so exciting, so I didn't find time to produce the picture because this result is truly remarkable. look, when p is bigger than 2, we have this discontinuous characteristic function plus something profile, which means that our ground states, rescale ground state V epsilon, form a very sharp boundary layer or phase transition, if you want, in around radius r. They converge uniformly to zero outside the support, and they converge to something which is above certain profile, which is above the characteristic function on the support. And apparently this is precisely the result observed by Chavani in his physical astrophysical work done in a physical, non-rigorous manner. And this is the result we couldn't understand in the beginning, and which in a sense motivated this study. So this is Thomas Fermi limit. So let me come back to the picture. So we now covered all what we call subcritical regions. Here we have P0 and P0 as a limit equation. Here we have Choquard as a limit equation. Here we have Thomas Fermi as a limit equation, and this could involve this sharp transition in the case P equal or greater or equal than 2. What happened here on the green line, on the separate threshold line, we have self-rescaling from the beginning, so we know exactly what happens. What happens here and here? These lines, they are not covered by previous result because limit equation P0 doesn't have solutions on this line. And Choquard equation in the next region also doesn't have solution on this line. So something different should happen in this critical regime. And what happened in this critical regime goes, this study goes back to our earlier paper with Kirill Muratov in the local case. So this is just the theorem, and I will try to explain it just pointing at the theorem. So now we are on the vertical critical line here. We're on this blue line here. P is a critical, something like Choquard / Sobolev critical exponent. So I fix P and Q is bigger than this the critical Sobolev number, then the limit equation doesn't involve 3 terms anymore. This involves only 2 terms. And the limit equation becomes something like the critical Choquard equation. To understand this, take alpha equals 0 in this equation. Then this transforms into standard critical Emden-Fowler equation or critical Sobolev equations, which is scale invariant. And it does not have unique solution, but it has a family of dilations of radial solutions, which are minimizers of the corresponding Sobolev inequalities, everybody knows here. The Choquard equation is very, very close to this critical Sobolev equation. And the result with Muratov in the local case and our current result in the non-local Choquard case, effectively tells that if you fix one of the ground states of the limit equation, because we don't have any more one solution or one ground state, we have a family. So to establish convergence, you need to fix one. So fix a ground state with coefficient 1 in the rescaling. Then there exists a rescaling lambda epsilon, which is described in these terms, such that V epsilon, this rescaled ground state of my problem P epsilon, converges to the ground state, to the chosen ground state of the critical Choquard equation. What is lambda epsilon is unclear and totally unintuitive. All previous rescalings were perfectly intuitive once you start looking on it. But lambda epsilon now is, as I said, implicit and counterintuitive. If n is greater or equal than 5, this is described, this is function which is equivalent, asymptotically equivalent to this power. When n equals 3 and 4, we have different power, and when n equals 4, we have a logarithmic correction. This is, of course, due to the fact that the limit profile for my Emden-Fowler equation is not in L2 in low dimensions. So L2 norm of the ground state U epsilon blows up. You can avoid it. If you are to have convergence, the L2 norm must blow up. And this forces different rates of rescalings in different dimensions. So for Choquard case, this result relies, so this ground state is known in low dimensions. At least there was a recent and wonderful result by Min Bai Yang with his collaborators who proved that the only ground states, that all ground states of the critical Choquard equations is given by the rescalings of this familiar Sobolev minimizer, remarkably. They proved it in dimensions 3 and 4, and they proved it in dimensions greater or equal than 5, under some mild technical restrictions. They have some restrictions on parameter alpha. The Minba said that they believe this result is true always, but they can't do it in dimensions greater or equal than 5. So we can believe that this is, so general, our general result, we converge to a fixed ground state. Just choose a ground state, fix it, and then there is a rescaling lambda epsilon. But in practice, this ground state probably belongs to this family, at least in low dimensions. Now, similar result we can establish. So now let me cover this line. This is what we call critical Hardy-Littlewood-Sobolev line. And in this region, my critical equation is something what we call critical HLS equation. This again contains just two terms, doesn't contain the Laplacian term. And this is formally Euler-Lagrange equation, or as equivalent to Euler-Lagrange equation of the Hardy-Littlewood-Sobolev inequality. And at least since celebrated papers by Lieb, we know that this family of equations and its dilations describe minimizers of the for the Hardy-Littlewood-Sobolev inequality, but this is adjusted for the power p. Of course, you can here you can, instead of v to the p, you can write rho, and this will change the power here on the left-hand side, and you get precisely, you're then precisely in the Lieb setting. Again, the result reads more or less exactly the same. There exists, so fix a ground state in this family, just take the parameter equal one in the rescaling, for instance. And then there exists a rescaling such that V epsilon converge to this ground state. Lambda epsilon in high dimensions and n equals 3 is actually simple. It's just equivalent to the asymptotically equivalent to the epsilon, inverse root of epsilon. When we are in dimension 3 and when alpha is big enough, then in this range we have only two-sided estimates on lambda, and they're completely unintuitive. In the previous result, we have just two-sided, sharp two-sided estimates. Here estimates are different. We believe that left-hand side bounds are optimal, but we cannot improve right-hand side to get optimality, at least at the moment. So this work is still a little bit, there is something in progress. We hope to get it sometime soon. And again, this non-standard rescalings, they're due to the fact that this ground state is not in L2 when P is in this and in this regimes. So I will show on the next slide the picture again. So in the abstract, I promised 6 different asymptotic regimes for the Choquard equation, and here they are. So this is P0 in 2 different ridges. This is Thomas Fermi, Choquard, critical Choquard, critical Hardy-Littlewood-Sobolev and self-rescaling regime. And this picture, this complexity, to be honest, we did not expect from the beginning. One comment, what happens in the local case, if you take alpha equals 0, then these two lines coincide, and then you see Q becomes equal to 2P. And then this yellow region collapses, it simply disappears, and green line coincides with the violet line, and it becomes just the region Q equal to P when the local problem is not really well posed, is nonlinear equation. So this structure disappears. The next observation here is that when we are in the local case, essentially we have existence only for epsilon small. In the non-local case, we have existence for arbitrary small and large epsilon. Small epsilon typically correspond to small mass, large epsilon correspond to large mass in the system. Self-gravitating Bose-Einstein condensate point, remember this physical equation, this physical model from the beginning. This point is somewhere here in this region. So when epsilon small, we have Choquard limit for the physical case. But on the next slide, this is the same situation, dual situation, when epsilon goes to infinity. You know, recognize the lines and the general structure, but everything becomes mirrored and the structure becomes, in a sense, less complex. So we have we don't have critical higher-less regime. We have Choquard regime here in this region, self-rescaling here in this region, and Thomas Fermi regime in the upper triangle, just three limit problems. Again, physical case sits somewhere here. The limit problem is Thomas Fermi. The limit equation here is compactly supported free boundary Thomas Fermi minimizer. And this is what was observed by physicists because they observed a free boundary, sort of free boundary behavior in the self-gravitating Bose-Einstein condensate, self-induced, because typically it's induced by some confining potential. They need to add coercive potential, which goes to plus infinity to confine Bose-Einstein liquid in the experiment. But the claim in the physical papers that if you add self-gravitation, the external confinement might be not needed. And this is what we observe here. This is a consequence of this compact support property in the limit when epsilon is large, when mass is large. So here I'm going to talk to finish my talk, and I finish it with mnogoe leto, which means in Russian, my reference source, I'm sure, can read this. This means many years to Laurent and Marie Françoise, and great thanks also to organizers for smooth running of this wonderful workshop. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you very much.